begin with me. Let this be the moment now. With every step I take, let this be my solemn vow. To take each moment and live each moment in peace eternally. Let there be peace on earth, and let
I can change the world with my own two hands, make it a better place with my own two hands, make it a kinder place with my own two hands, with my own, with my own two hands. I can make peace on earth with my own two hands. I can clean up the earth with my own two hands. I can reach out to you with my own two hands, with my own, with my own two hands. Make it a brighter place with my own two hands. I'm gonna make it a safer place with my own two hands. I'm gonna help the human race with my own two hands, with my own, with my own two hands. for you. With my own two hands, but you got to use. Use your own two hands. Use your own. Use your own two hands. Use your own.
sorry.
Thank you.
everyone. I'm Virginia Rome Garcia. I've lived here in Hermiston, in the Hermiston area for 44 years. And I am so pleased to be here with you guys all this tonight, this evening. I am just so grateful to have the opportunity to share my thoughts and feelings with you guys this tonight. So let's talk about unity. Let's talk about the power of unity. It's a common thing to come together as a community. It's only good for our community, and we stand stronger together when we come together. Okay, should we start again? Okay, I'm Virginia Rome Garcia, and I lived here in Hermiston for the past 44 years, well, in the area for the past 44 years. My children all went to school here, and I'm just pleased to be able to share my thoughts and my feelings here today. So, let's talk about the power of unity. Unity is coming together for the common good of our community. We stand together stronger when we come together. Unity is important because it allows us to achieve things that would be difficult on our own. When we unite, we overcome any challenge that comes our way. It helps to build bridges, break down barriers, and create an environment where everyone is valued as an individual. Let's look at an inspiring story or inspiring history in our country. It's Martin Luther King Jr., this brave young man that came to, and he was the one that showed the power of unity in the face of discrimination and injustice. So let's all consider all individuals, their race, background, and social background, and social class. Join together to fight the equality and spark the change. Another example of unity is the Olympic Games, where athletes come from different countries to compete in the spirit of unity and the sportsmanship. Despite all their differences, they find common ground, inspiring us with their shared passion of the sports. We can embrace unity in our own lives. It starts with treating others with kindness and respect, regardless of their differences. It means listening to the different perspective and finding common ground. It means together for a more inclusive community. In conclusion, unity is not just a nice word. It is the power force that can transform individuals, communities, and even the world. Let's remember that when we come together, we can achieve greatness. So let's unite, support one another, create a future where unity is at the core of everything we do. Unity is a gift of God, the success and the growth and the glory. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Michi Duncan. Before I go any further, I'd like to thank Julie Puzzi for the opportunity to participate in this incredible unity celebration. I also want to thank Cassie for connecting me to Julie. I am an immigrant from southern Japan, so please excuse my southern accent. Like many of you, my family was greatly impacted by three extraordinarily generous people who gently ushered us into one of big family. That's what the unity means to me. You can be a part of big family or big community. And while we were strangers and foreigners, like many of you, we had the great people walking alongside of us. First, Maria. She was my mentor in my first year in the United States. She immigrated from Cuba 10 years prior to us meeting at work. Remembered her first days. Maria took me under her wings and guided me through rough spots by sharing herself, such as struggles with language and culture shock. She became the bridge for me to cross over into the life in America. Because of Maria investing in me, I am always willing to reach out to those who are struggling in my old shoes. Second, Lee. My husband's work landed us on a Portuguese island in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean. We were foreigners. Then Lee, our neighbor, knocked on our door with smiles. She shared her family's difficult days in the U.S. and their decision to return to take care of their aging parents, just like many of us do. Her family was our ambassadors to the island community. They included us in their family gathering, took us to the local events, introduced us to people in the community. Furthermore, Lee took care of our little toddlers and me when I was incapacitated with an illness in my husband's absence. She saved my life. Lee's family integrated us into our island family. Third, Hermiston neighbors. We moved here nearly 30 years ago. As soon as we parked our moving truck and loaded pickup, our neighbors were there with work clothes on and ready to help us unload. They welcomed us and made us realize we're in a great neighborhood. They continue to assist us with the country living. For example, one neighbor taught us how to maintain our well and cut down huge trees. Our neighbors enabled us to join our neighborhood family. In conclusion, many of us had Maria, Lee, and neighborhood families. When we are strangers and foreigners, as Hermiston is becoming quite an international town, we have great opportunities to befriend our new neighbors with compassion and passion. Thank you.
So, we are going to do some clogging for you. And a clogging is truly an American dance form. It began in the Appalachian Mountains a very, very, very long time ago. And now it is enjoyed widespread throughout all the United States and around the world. A long time ago, like in the 1700s, we began to be bringing in like some of the Irish and the Scottish and the English and Dutch Germans, and they kind of all got together for some folk dances, and they started doing some toe tapping and some foot stomping and some impromptu noise with their feet, and they soon started accompanying that with some fiddle and some bluegrass music, and pretty soon, clogging evolved from that. Now, the name actually came from, there was a group that went to perform for the Queen of England, and she said that the footwork that they did was very much like clogging from her country, and so the term kind of stuck when the media used the term in documenting that performance. The step dance became known as clog dancing. Today, it's a lot less impromptu, but it's still very rhythmic. It's become a little bit more complicated than the simple steps that they used to do before. And now we have a lot of influences creeping in, stuff, a little bit of tap dance, a little bit of jazz, some hip hop, even some street dancing. You see a lot of different influences, some country line dancing, some things like that have all come into the style. And now you get truly what is a melting pot of dance, and you get some clogging. So this evening you'll be privileged to hear and see Generation Cloggers. They're a local group, and they will be performing for you from to a song by Brooks and Dunn, Boot Scootin' Boogie.
Get down! so excited that I forgot it was my turn to come up here. I cut my hair thinking it was gonna cool me off, and I'm just always hot. But I'm so happy to see everyone. There's a lot of people that have come out here today. So I was asked by Julie to come out and speak today about community, and I thought I would write something, and she gave me a lot of time to actually do something, but I didn't, and I was like, I'll go just shoot from the heart. Pretty good at that. So I want to share a story with you guys about my day. Just hoping that it give you guys some inspiration to lift others up. So this morning I woke up and I got to talk to my two sisters. They live in New York. And all we talk about typically is our cats. We all have cats, and how one is better than the other. One has a crooked tail and it's not, you know, it doesn't add up. It's not really a cat. It's not the good cat. Get rid of the cat. But after that, I decided to get up and I purchased this guitar from Amazon thinking that I'm gonna be a rock star. I'm gonna be a rock star with a $100 guitar. It sounded like crap, so I ran down to the music store to this guy who I really don't know his name, but he puts up with my crap. And he's like, yeah, that guitar is not good. And I was like, I know, right? He's like, well, how much did you pay for it? I said, $120. And he's like, well, that's what you get for $120. And I'm like, oh, well, what can I do? He's like, well, buy a guitar. Like, well, I need to become a rock star first. But this really great guy, I remember his name. His name is John. He comes in and he sees me holding a guitar and I start playing it. He's like, please don't be shy. Don't mind me. And I'm like, I'm not shy. I'm going to be a rock star. And so I start playing and he gets excited. So he grabs a guitar off the wall and he plugs into an amp and he starts playing. And I'm in shock. This guy was playing the blues and I love the blues. And I'm just standing there and he's just like, he's looking at me like, are you okay? And I'm just like, oh. I couldn't even make, I was just like making noise. But from there, this guy seen how passionate I was about learning how to play the guitar, that he's like, hey, I teach classes on how to make guitars. I'm like, no, I can't even play. He's like, well, I have a guitar and I made it and I was gonna donate it. And you're like super passionate about this and I want you to continue doing this. Just take this guitar and I'm like, you're gonna give me a guitar? So I came in with a $120 guitar, and I leave with a priceless guitar. This guy named John makes guitars and sells them all over the country. I have his name, if you guys want to look him up. I have his Instagram. He's famous, and I didn't know. Like, I live in little old Pendleton. It's like, all these meeting famous people here. That's why I'm here, because someday I'm going to be a rock star. So I just wanted to share with you guys, like, when you're really passionate about something, people can see that. And as a community, we need to lift each other up, especially when we see the passion in them. There are things that people might think is odd, but if that's their thing, let's encourage them to do it and do it well. It means a lot to them. This meant so much to me that I had to come tell you guys about it today, because it just instilled in me like this is what I'm supposed to be doing. I am supposed to play the guitar and enjoy playing the guitar for myself and then share the beautiful music that I play and play for others. So next time when Julie invites me, I'm going to be up here playing the guitar. Okay? So get ready for that. I don't want to go over my time, but I did want to also share. I work for a really great organization called EOCIL, Eastern Oregon Center for Independent Living. We're quite small, but we do a lot of work. Right now I'm working with people who use substances, and it's challenging, but I know and I see that they need a lot of our support. And if you can, and you see someone who might be houseless or on substances, understand that some of them are just not using the substances to have fun and party. Some of them really are self-medicating. And due to the lack of mental health in our area, some of them are suffering and they're trying to treat themselves. So if you just give them a little bit of grace, because they are a part of our community as well. So just a little bit of grace and know that someday we can lift these people up too, out of this. We have great organizations here in Hermiston that I partner with, and they're doing the great work. And I know you guys coming out here today, community is very important to you. So let's just keep loving on each other and lifting each other up. And thank you so much for having me, Julie. Thank you guys for having me. And I hope that I rock your socks off when I come back with my guitar that was given to me. So thank you so much.
When we sing, something mysterious happens. We're transported, enabled, inspired, transformed in a way that can only be experienced through song. We invite you to join us in a musical journey as we present a song by Mike Wilson entitled When We Sing.
My mother was a single mother, and I think she did all right with us. I have had government officials from the city and state level, the U.S. level. But I think for me, the most important thing is that I get to lend my voice, have the opportunity to sit with them, to speak for people who don't have the voice for themselves. So in that, I think the best way that I can help anybody out is to kind of give you guys the keys to success that I've used. First thing would be social media. Don't worry about the likes. Too many people put too much emphasis on whether somebody's liking my photo, liking what I'm doing. Don't worry about it. People aren't going to like you no matter what you do. As I say, haters are going to hate. It's just how it is. Be courageous, but I don't mean to come up here to be courageous. Just in your life, be courageous enough to be authentic to yourself. Pay attention, listen to what your core values are, your intuition, and go with that. Go with whatever passion is there in front of you to speak about. Forget about self-limiting beliefs. You know, we tell ourselves, I can't do this, I'm not good enough. The reality is, it takes one conversation with one person at a time to change the world. Be open-minded. You never know what you're going to learn from anybody. You know, you could be passing by somebody down the sidewalk and have a small conversation, and that 2 seconds that you talk to them could change your life, change your perspective on things. In all reality, sitting with officials and round tables and other leaders in the area, I really appreciate being able to sit with people who become a different people. So I celebrate their diversity, because I don't have a big picture, and I don't have the best perspective, or I don't know what you mean. But together we can figure it out. Something that I will preach about that isn't being talked about anymore is tolerance. It's okay not to like the opinion somebody else has, not to agree with them. It doesn't mean I have to hate you. We can still be friends afterwards. You can explain to me your portion of it, and I can decide if I like it or not. Have humility. Really know that you don't have all the answers. And you don't have to. That's what we have people, friends for. That also sparks growth. We can't grow if we're sitting in the same circle. You need different people in your lives. If you're the smartest person in the room, get out of the room. Go find another one. When in this world where we're working with the community, a lot of times I run across people who are so focused on an agenda, they're not worried about who they're talking to. It's how can I get this job done? Who fits this puzzle that it's going to get me from A to B? I focus on the relationships. Can we talk as people and see eye to eye and work on a solution? And if not, that's okay. Maybe you know somebody that can help out. And the most important part, be courageous, be a light. Our world right now, since post-COVID, has been so dark. It's a simple conversation with a kid, your neighbor, that could change their whole day or even the whole world. Sometimes just being there for somebody means a whole lot. And if we're all doing that, then together, we can all stand and be the little lights in the world, and little by little, and create the change that we all like to see.
Thank you. really inspired her to make this happen. She's like, yes, that's the feeling I want. That's what we want to do. We want to reconnect and we want to love each other again. So we wanted to show this video to you tonight, and we hope that you'll get the same feeling that we got when we watched it. But before we do that, I need everybody to know that we are streaming this live right now. I may need a workbook from the thing, but I think it's on Hermiston State YouTube. Is that right? Yes. Hermiston State YouTube. That's not like a state that you eat, but a state that you pound in the ground. Okay? Hermiston State YouTube. And it's going to be recorded, and you can watch it later, is what I think. Is that right? Get a workbook? Okay. Great. So, I have this story that I want to tell you. I'm not sure that we have time for that, but I just do it anyway because it's super funny. So, my husband has this, well, she's passed now, but this grandmother that is, she's from Mexico. She's, you know, just straight and tall and this beautiful, strong woman, raised a bunch of kids on her own. Brought her to America. Just this incredible woman, right? Well, as she gets older, she sells her home in California and makes a ton of money. Remember when everything was super overpriced? That's when she sold her home. So she made all this money, bought a brand new house in kind of a ritzy part of town, I guess. And the first time she goes out shopping, she's getting some kind of funny looks from people. And she puts her nose in the air with all the pride that she can muster, and she's like, I belong in this neighborhood. I'm not going to let them push me out. And she marches through the grocery store, and she gets everything that she needs. She goes out to the parking lot, and a lady comes up to her and says, ma'am, are you okay? You know, is everything okay? She said, of course it's okay. Busters her pride again. How dare they look down on me, she says. And she loads the groceries into her car, putting everything in. Please notice the position that I'm in. You're going to want this for later. She's putting things in her car. Well, she has some books she needs to return to a neighbor, so she goes to his house. He answers the door, and you know what? He's acting funny, too. And she's like, you know what? These white people, right? Attitude. And she is just not digging it at all. So she kind of, she's a little bit snotty with him as she returns the books, lets him know that, she's not really digging him either. And she gets home. She gets her groceries unloaded, goes into her bedroom, and realized that she forgot to put her pants on. So she's wearing her red underwear with her pantyhose and her high heels, because you gotta dress up to go shopping when you're in a ritzy part of town. So the reason I tell you this story is that sometimes we make judgments about the way people are treating us. We assume that we know what's happening. We assume that they're looking down on us, that they're doing so well. Maybe we're just in our pantyhose, okay? And they're trying to help us out, like, ma'am, are you okay? Because you're not wearing your pants today. So maybe we should just chill out a little bit. Be just a little bit kinder. When people seem judgy and terrible, maybe just check to see if you're wearing your pants. That's all I can say. Anyway, it's just easy to mix up, isn't it? And we do it all the time. We make judgments. My mom is fabulous with this stuff, with the people stuff. My dad maybe not so much, but if you want to know how many centimeters it is from this auditorium to the highest peak on the moon, my dad's the guy. But maybe not from people stuff. But my mom says that, if you're going to make stuff up about people, because we do that all the time, make up something that makes you feel good and makes them seem like a new person. And that has been a great, that served me well my whole life. You know, when somebody cuts you off in traffic, sing your song. And then they're trying to get to their new baby in the hospital. I'm so excited for them. You give them a little wave and you get out of the way and you have just helped the world be a better place. Even if they are a jerk, you feel better now. So if you're going to make crap up, make good crap up. And I hope that as you watch this video, you'll kind of catch the vision. Seeing people in a different way. So with nothing else, I think we're ready to do our video. Enjoy.
Sometimes it's easier to jump to conclusions than walk across the street. It's like I'd rather fill the blanks with illusions than take the time to see. You are trying to close the back door of your car. You are balancing the groceries and a baby in your arms. You are more than just a sign in your front yard. You are my neighbor. I can get so lost in the mission. Defending what I think. I've been surfing on a sea of opinions, but just behind the screen.
everybody. My name's Sean Lockwood. These are my grandkids. A few months ago, my good friends, Julie and Susie, asked me if I would say a few words about how the construction of making a quilt could demonstrate love and unity in our community. At the time, of course, I said yes. How could I say no to these two lovely ladies who have been a part of my life and part of my kids' lives for as long as I could remember? And further, how hard could it be to talk about one of my most treasured pastimes? The definition of quilting is defined as a warm bed covering made of padding enclosed between layers of fabric put in place by lines of stitching. And yes, that's true, but so much more. Quilting goes back to 3400 BCE. You guys okay back there? No? This was a test. We'll see how it goes. But probably not in terms as I spoke, used more as a body protection from armor. Quilting has, he's fine. He can just hold the quilt up above. Yeah, there you go. I'm not nervous anymore. Quilting has stood the test of time, covering all nations, races, and religions. I'm sure many people here today have a family heirloom locked away in an attic or closet. You really should get it out and start loving on it, clearly. All right, okay, whatever. During the Depression era, women would come together, commonly known as sewing bees, and stitch together making quilts that they could distribute to those in need, often stitched using old clothing. This action often relieved stress during those times. Tonight, I'd like to talk about this quilt here. This quilt is a great example of unity. All right. Without unity in this particular quilt, there would have been no way for me to cut up perfectly good fabric into tiny pieces and attempt to piece it back together and make something this beautiful. This type of unity required to construct a quilt like this takes no less patience and perseverance and love than it does to get along with our neighbors, friends, and even coworkers. Our community is a melting pot of people coming from someplace and is growing like crazy. Yes, there are many people here tonight that were born and raised here. My kids and grandchildren are an example of that. And for that, I could not be more grateful. But this area is growing. And as we welcome new people to our community, we need to bind together to continue our goal of maintaining a beautiful community that love, diversity, and unity. As you look at this quilt, you can see the design right here, connecting all these blocks with tiny pieces, these beautiful colors all coming together to make a beautiful whole. This quilt is a visual example. If we put in the effort, our community can be one of unity and love. Now, I think everyone was given a little red ticker when you came in. And if you don't have one, maybe let us know. And if you don't have one, are there any other more tickets maybe from somewhere? Oh, we're out of tickets? Okay.
right.
We have a match. And what is your name?
Jason Blake.
Awesome. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
And would you mind staying up here for a couple minutes? All right. So as you go away tonight,
love our community, and we think that together we can make a huge difference. Thank you.
There comes a time when we eat
Enjoy the refreshments. It's going to be awesome.